Good morning and welcome. My name is Michael Cooper White. I am the interim president of Brite Divinity School, and on behalf of the school, it is my privilege to welcome all of you to this grand day of celebration. It's a beautiful day outside. You might imagine many people are claiming credit for being in charge of the weather, but we know who truly is. Indeed, this is the day that our God has made for us. We are indebted to so many who have brought us to this day, and we will have opportunity to thank them as our celebration goes on. But a special word of appreciation to University Christian Church for once again being such gracious hosts for this hooding ceremony. We will begin with the call to worship led by the Reverend Dr. Aretha Fluker.
Good morning. Please rise in either body or spirit. Holy One, we welcome your presence in this space as we gather to worship.
Thank you. said, Holy One, we are people who really desire to be excited about life and the opportunities that have been afforded us to enjoy rich and varied experiences, to exercise responsible autonomy, to be creative, and to enjoy the privilege of abundant living. We do wish to be grateful for our association with Brite Divinity School, with its values of academic excellence, inclusive justice, and life-giving practice. Yet we are often intimidated by challenging news, news that ranges from what some perceive as inadequate justice, the challenge of social fragmentation and increasing intolerance across our nation, the seeming rise of authoritarianism in many settings across the globe, while war-ravaged Ukraine tumbles into another winter when suffering will be deeply compounded. And as refugees and other migrants search desperately for new life among mostly inhospitable strangers, even as many across the globe wither away from hunger and disease, and we often worry that the foundations of our personal lives are crumbling, we yearn for clearer insight, and we desire to feel even a little less incompetent than we often do. And on mornings like this, we seek after some assurance that Brite graduates and those of us who have helped prepare them for service in the world can make some difference that has lasting impact in human life and our planet as a whole. So, dear God, we wish this invocation to be more than formal acknowledgement of your presence among us today. Instead, we pray for open hearts and minds and attuned spirits that allow us to enjoy a genuine encounter with you through ritual performance fellowship and through the inspiration, challenge, and call that will come to us through the words that constitute the sermon preached by Michael Cooper White. So, dear God, in desperate hope, we declare ourselves ready for immersion into your vision of the radical transformation that is possible in the world on a micro and macro level. And we invite you to come close to us, and by your spirit sink so deep into us that we see with transformed eyes that provide sharper vision. We will hear with better tuned ears. We will consider with minds that have been renewed, and we will take on the tasks of life with purpose that is most consistent with your holy will. We ask that you listen to us, that you challenge us, that you comfort us, and that you walk with us through the life that is ahead. Amen.
This passage from the Hebrew Bible is 1 Kings chapter 19. From 9b through 21. This is the word of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, What are you doing here, Elijah? He answered, I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant. Throw down your altars and kill your prophets with a sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away. He said, Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not. And the earthquake of fire, but the Lord was not. and enter the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah hurried, he wrapped his face in his mantle. Then there came a voice to him that said, "Why are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts. For the Israelites have forsaken the covenant, thrown down the altars, and killed your prophets with a sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." Then the Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king of Aram. Also you shall anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. And you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah, as prophet in your place. Whoever escapes from the sword of Hazael, Jehu shall kill. And whoever escapes from the sword of Jehu, Elisha shall kill. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, Adonis that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." So he set out from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat, who was plowing. There were 12 yoke of oxen ahead of him, and he was with the 12. Elijah passed by him and threw his mantle over him. He left the oxen, ran after Elijah, and said, "Let me kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow you." Then Elijah said to him, "Go back again, for what have I done to you?" He returned from following him, took the yoke of oxen, and slaughtered them. Using the wicked mouth from the oxen, he boiled their flesh and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he set out and followed Elijah and became his servant. This is the word of the Lord.
The New Testament reading this morning is from the book of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 25 to 30. At that time, Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." Words of wisdom, words of hope. Thanks.
Grace, mercy, and peace be with all. In the name of the God who was, who is, and who is to come, Emmanuel. Amen. So, graduates about to be, what more is there to say but congratulations to you who are receiving these degrees for which you have worked so long and so hard. Behind you are all of those who have been your supporters, your encouragers, your cheerleaders. In front of you sits a faculty who have been your mentors. As I have said of my own teachers, most of them now departed, you will never get these folks out of your heads and hearts. Almost every day, a phrase uttered by one of my professors still comes to mind 5 decades after it was spoken. All of us gathered here today join in a collective, unfettered congratulations to each of you. Now, I can imagine some other T-I-O-N words that may be on your minds this morning. Jubilation, celebration, expectation, anticipation, maybe a measure of trepidation at an unknown future, conclusion of a chapter of education, but by no means the end, for that must go on lifelong. Maybe liberation from all those assignments, papers, deadlines, reading lists, and requirements. Emancipation from tuition bills. But above all those words describing a state of heart and mind, this December 17, 2022 marks for you a day of transformation. More about that in just a bit. So here we are, adorned in all this academic finery, occasions that happen only rarely. Even our longest-serving faculty members will tell you they've probably worn those colorful robes only a few dozen times in the life of a career. The various colors of robes of the faculty, by the way, represent the span of prestigious institutions from which they have earned the highest degrees. Ph.D. degrees are often referred to as terminal degrees. That could suggest they almost kill you. And I see all the heads nodding. There were days when survival was in doubt. So these are really rare and special occasions when we pull out all the stops and dress up as we do this day and as thousands have done for generations before us. Now, for our many guests out there who may be somewhat unfamiliar with the symbolism of our attire, let me offer a few words of explanation. Starting at the top, the caps worn by those about to graduate are often referred to as mortar boards. If you've ever seen a bricklayer at work, you'll get the reference. A skilled bricklayer has a board with a handle on the back in one hand that holds the mortar she uses to hold the bricks in place. While academic ceremonies to mark the completion of a course of study were first held in Europe, when they were held, centuries ago, there was no more revered craftsperson than a journey bricklayer. The one on whose skills homes, barns, granaries, city walls, security were built. So to symbolize achievements in learning, graduates began wearing on their heads a hat resembling a mortar board. That's one tradition. Others claim the square hat tradition had its origins from some medieval institution convinced that those square hats simply resembled a book. You can take your choice. Wearing robes, historians trace back to the founding of European universities in the 12th or 13th centuries. And they had their origin in a very practical purpose. Since the earliest students were almost all studying theology, events like this were held in great cathedrals, which were freezing cold most of the year. So robes simply help stave off the frigid temperatures. Now the addition of hoods may have come about for a similar reason, to cover the head, perhaps predating the mortarboards. Since many of the early students were monks with shaved heads, a true hood may have covered that part of the body through which most of our bodily heat is lost. Or maybe some vain monks just felt their shaved heads were unattractive and introduced hoods to appear a bit more dashing. Now there's another explanation for hoods that many historians find somewhat dubious and discredited. The hoods might have been the first means of collecting financial aid or paying off student loans. In other words, there may have been a time when graduation gifts of coins or cash were deposited anonymously by family and friends in the graduates' hoods. You can try that today and see how it goes. And there was another variation of that, which suggested that faculty members wore hoods so that the students could drop coins to show their appreciation for outstanding lectures. Faculty members, be sure to check your hoods before you hang them back in the closet today. Today there are hoods of different colors and different lengths. The longer the hood, the longer, the more substantial the degree, and hoods bear the school's official colors. So that's a bit surrounding academic regalia, which circulates broadly in all academic circles. But I want to suggest to you that for those receiving a degree from a divinity school, there's a longer history and a richer legacy that can be attached to this hooding ceremony. And that brings us back to this day, to the true significance of this day as a time of transformation. Let us take ourselves all the way back, 3 millennia or so, to the great prophetic tradition recorded in the Hebrew Bible. We heard the story as Pastor Jang read it just a few moments ago. Elijah, the great prophet, had been told by God that his days were numbered and he needed to appoint a successor. So the scripture reads, Elijah departed from the wilderness and found Elisha the son of Shaphat, who was plowing in the field. And Elijah passed by Elisha and cast his mantle upon him. Now the mantle in ancient times was simply an outer garment, probably originally made of fur, which helped ward off the cold. But in the great Hebrew prophetic tradition, the mantle, or adaret, from dear meaning powerful, became a symbol of the prophet, a spokesperson for Yahweh, interpreter of the word, challenger of the status quo, seeker, even demander of justice. Well, it seems to me that an academic hood from a theological school must carry in its meaning a high degree of connection to the great prophetic tradition's mantle. Well, maybe a bit of a stretch. Perhaps 1 Kings could be rendered. So Elijah found farmer Elisha plowing in the field, and he hooded him. Perhaps the best meaning of a theological degree I have heard was offered 2 decades ago by a graduating senior at my former institution. At Gettysburg Seminary, we only had 1 graduation in May each year. And in the weeks leading up to it, I invited all the seniors in small groups for a leisurely lunch at my home. I referred to it as their exit interview. It was a time to reflect back over the years at the school, reminiscing about the high points, but then also going on to tell us what we could do better for those who came after the graduates. Year in and year out, we took notes, offered a summary to the board of directors, took seriously that feedback. My very first year as president, at the first luncheon, as I recall, Chad Rimmer offered his assessment with a double negative. Now, he said, I can never not think theologically about everything. I can never not think theologically about everything. In other words, from now on, I will and I must see everything through the lenses of this theological education and formation bestowed upon me. So I think that's part of the meaning of the hoods we bestow upon you and place upon your shoulders. Now, wait just a minute, some of you might be thinking, that's a heavy burden to lay on us on a day that's supposed to be purely celebration, festive, joyful, celebrating all that we've accomplished, all that we've survived, we, the COVID generation of theological students. But I won't sugarcoat it. A theological degree does bestow a burden. The burden of entering into the fray of our deeply polarized current situation, naming the injustices that surround us on every side, lifting up visions of a peaceable realm in which it seems not too many are interested. The burden of a theological degree today may be just as great as the mantle thrust upon Elisha by Elijah. Ah, but lest you despair, be sure to remember a further word from another later prophet. Knowing the weight of responsibility he was casting upon his followers, the prophet Jesus said that his burden could be borne lightly, even with a measure of joyful buoyancy. Take my mantle upon you. Wear this hood I am bestowing. For my yoke is easy. My burden is bearable and lighter than you might imagine. So never forget that these yokes, these mantles, these hoods that you are about to receive, bear within them all the wisdom, all the promises of all the ages. Woven into the fabric of those hoods, God created the heavens and earth, and God declared it was good. Rainbows are a reminder God desires a restored, not a devastated planet. Liberation from human bondage was not a one-time thing at the Sea of Reeds. God so loves the world. Take that, all you white Christian nationalists out there. Nothing in all creation can separate us from the love of God. And in the final words, the final book of Scripture, behold, there will be a new heaven and a new earth. ages were woven into that mantle, that yoke that Jesus the prophet promised to bestow. And he issued constant reminders that prophetic mantle wearing goes better when we do not try to go it alone. Contrary to common perceptions that the great Hebrew Bible prophets were lone rangers, there were actually prophetic schools, communities of faithful message bearers. Elijah was reminded of that when God said, "No, don't despair, there are 7,000 others out there who remain faithful." While the stories may read as though Yahweh simply called and consigned a prophet to a lonely existence, those prophets were formed in and sustained by communities of the faithful. And continuing in that prophetic tradition, Jesus' followers were urged to go out at least two by two. Most of the time, it appears the whole lot wandered about in a posse. So mantle wearing, burden bearing goes better when you go out in the company of others with common commitments and shared visions. So now, if you cling to those promises handed down to us from all who have worn mantles thrust upon them down through the ages, then these theological hoods we place upon you, for all the burdens they bear, can sit light and easy on your shoulders. If you go in community, challenging and slower and more frustrating as it may be at times, you will go farther. And you will avoid burning out along the way. If you remember that you are but a sower who cannot control the bounty of the harvest, then at day's end you will hear the still small voices blessing, "Well done, good and faithful servants. Well done." In the end, above all, in ways you will discover slowly, gradually, across all years to come. With these hoods, you are not bound to stodgy traditions and oppressive expectations. You need not be weighed down by others' projections and demands upon you. Rather, be very clear that as these mantles are placed upon you this day, henceforth and forevermore, you are yoked to freedom in a new kind of way, yoked to liberation, to transformation. If you look at them again with eyes transformed, could it be these mantles of your theological degrees are not so much hoods or yokes at all? Might it just be they are wings?
Thank you. name is Dr. Lance Poppy. Dr. Shelley Matthews and I will be reading the citations for the master's degrees. All persons who completed the requirement for graduation from a master's program in August, and also all those who have done so this week, are listed in the program. You can see it on the very back of the program. All students. Those who are present today will be introduced and vested with their hoods by Drs. Natalia Cherry and Jeremy Williams. So the process is going to follow the order that's on the back of the program, except there is one error that I need to correct. And that is that Lillian Lathoni Kamau and Jacob Swindell are actually Masters of Theological Studies students, MTS students, and not MATM students. And we'll begin with the MTS. So Dr. Matthews and I will alternately read the citations, and as we do, come down, the students should come down, the graduates should come down to the center aisle, and should, the choreography of that can be worked out by Dr. Williams and Dr. Cherry. And then, after you receive your hood, go through the outside aisle and turn back. And so, of course, everyone's going to have to kind of switch to make room so they can get back in. All right. Receiving the Master of Theological Studies degree, Lillian Lathoni Kamau. Lillian earned a bachelor's degree in sustainable human development from the Catholic University of Eastern Africa. She also earned a master's degree in transformational leadership from St. Paul University, Kenya, and a higher diploma in urban theology from Carlisle College, which is also in Kenya. After Brite, Lillian will serve as an interim rector in the Episcopal Diocese.
Jacob Swindell. Jacob earned a bachelor's degree in biomedical science from Texas A&M University. After Brite, Jacob will work as a teacher in the Kaufman Independent School District.
Receiving the Master of Arts in Theology and Ministry degree, Amanda K. Kirksky. Amanda earned a bachelor's degree in marketing from Texas A&M University. After Brite, Amanda will work as a missions advocate with the General Board of Global Ministries of the United Methodist Church.
Receiving the Master of Divinity degree, Kirsten Bailey. University in Tiffin, Ohio. Kirsten is currently in the search and call process with the United Church of Christ. After Brite, she will also continue leading the business she founded, which focuses on spiritual accompaniment.
Marshall Breedlove. Earned a bachelor's degree in sound recording technology at Texas State University. After Brite, Marshall will continue as associate minister at First Christian Church of Plano, Texas.
After Brite, Brooke will be associate pastor to youth and young adults at Friends Congregational Church in College Station.
John degree in business administration from the University of Texas at Arlington. After Brite, Jonathan will continue as a pastor associated with the Christian Methodist Episcopal Church.
Hannah Warner. With an Oxbridge Literature and Theory focus at William Jewell College. After Brite, Anna will be a student chaplain at Washington Regional Hospital, Fayetteville, Arkansas.
Boston White. Boston earned a bachelor's degree in communications from Southeastern Oklahoma State University. After Brite, Boston will be associate pastor over family ministries and pastoral care at Aldersgate United Methodist Church.
Continue the reading of citations and hooding by paying attention now to our Ph.D. graduates. I invite Dr. Kamilah Hall Sharp. I will first read the citation, and then I will invite Professor Gaffney to vest her student. Dr. Hall Sharp's dissertation title, Survival is Not an Academic Skill, a Womanist Reading of the Book of Esther. A scholarly work in biblical interpretation, Dr. Hall Sharp's dissertation is focused on the Book of Esther, which is often interpreted as a survival story for the Jewish community. Dr. Hall Sharp adopts the position that focus on the communal survival narrative has overshadowed individual stories of survival to the point of near erasure. And she contends that the individual survival stories intertwine with their communal survival narrative when lifted up from the text, amplify unheard voices and experiences. In the foreground of Dr. Hall Sharp's analysis are the experiences of contemporary women, especially African American women, who struggle to survive without success in a society where black lives are not valued and where women are always in danger. As a self-identified womanist committed to the survival and thriving of all people, and acutely aware of at least quadricentric interests of gender, race, class, and language that stand in front of translation and exegetical questions, Dr. Hall Sharp brought to her textual investigation an awareness of the way black women endure communal and interpersonal trauma, struggle to survive, and fight for their voices to be heard.
Yes.
This made her wonder if pieces of the Esther story could create a picture of survival other than Jewish communal survival. That is, if Esther could speak to a broader vision of survival. Therefore, her dissertation builds upon Professor Dolores Williamson's hermeneutic of survival to construct a lexicon of survival as an exegetical framework to construct a trauma-informed womanist reading of individual survival stories in the Book of Esther. Focusing on the Masoretic text, which preserves the Hebrew version of Esther, Dr. Hall Sharp explored the sites of struggle, trauma, and survival in the text. Intending to add to the current conversation of Esther around sexual abuse and violence, her project's interpretive strategy places womanist discourse in an intentional conversation with trauma theory. In other words, She's developing a trauma-informed womanist hermeneutic. As she says, to read any text from a person on the margins perspective, and to give space to voices that have been rarely attended to and or silenced, as I intend, one must consider the role of trauma in the experience of marginalization. And the final analysis is Dr. Hall Sharp's hope that by identifying and reading survivor narratives, such as the Book of Esther, with a complex lens she identifies, tools for learning and healing from trauma may be generated. Survivors can draw on biblical texts such as Esther to tell or interpret their own stories and construct their own survival narratives. Through the survival narratives of the characters in the biblical text, current narratives wherein the voices of survivors have been silenced or ignored can be amplified. With this project, Dr. Hall Sharp intends to expand the womanist biblical interpretation library, so necessary for the field of biblical studies. Further, she's clear that scriptural survival narratives offer a promising foundation and frame for conversations around the issue of abuse and violence that happens so often in worshiping communities. The members of Dr. Hall Sharp's dissertation committee, Dr. Bill Gaffney, Dr. Ariel Feldman, Dr. Timothy Samuel, congratulate Kamilah on this important work. I now invite Professor Gaffney to hood a student. Participating in a moving ceremony. We're therefore pleased to have her back so that our community can celebrate with her and her family. Dr. Talbot's dissertation title, Bat Yiptop and Her Bleeding Body, a child-oriented reading of Judges 11, 29 through 40. The textual focus of Dr. Talbot's dissertation, as you've heard, is the disturbing story of Bat Yiptop in Judges 11, 29 through 40. There, Yiptop, the Gileadite, vows to offer up as a burnt offering to God whatever or whoever first greets him going out from the doors of his house as he returns from the battle with the Ammonites. It so happens that it is his daughter who emerges through the doors. A narrative detail surrounding this tragic occurrence takes the reader to the place where the daughter accepts her fate and is killed. Dr. Talbot's approach to the examination of this story is fueled primarily by her concern with children and with child characters in the Hebrew Bible. Relying on the relatively new lens in biblical scholarship of childist and child-oriented interpretations. Inspired by the work of feminist interpretation before it, childist and child-oriented interpretations seek not just to attend to the children in texts, but also, in doing so, to recognize and transform structures of domination in ways that, as Dr. Talbot puts it, make the world more hospitable for children. Dr. Talbot's effort presupposes a view that biblical texts themselves represent one of those structures of domination. In employing her methodological orientation, Dr. Talbot highlights the recognition that, while much has been said about Bhaktivedanta's status as daughter or woman, the significance of her situation as a child in transition has not been properly appreciated. In utilizing a point of entry opened by ambiguity and narrative gaps in the text, and presenting Bhaktivedanta as a transitional subject, neither woman nor child, Dr. Talbot has sought to provide an important corrective to static or rigid age-related categorizing of children and adults. With this child-adult binary and its underlying presuppositions being a reflection and natural extension of the interrogation of the binary used to enforce rigid gender categories. Inspired by insights from feminist, womanist, queer, and masculinity biblical scholarship, which have revealed the appropriateness of continuums rather than categories in constructions of gender, has affected gender relationality in the interpretation and reception of biblical texts. Dr. Talbot utilizes her interpretation of the Bhaktivedanta narrative as an interrogation of the child-adult binary in order to contribute to a child-oriented biblical scholarship and to influence it positively child-adult relationality. Confident that engaging the typically excluded middle of the child-adult binary allows previously unrecognized aspects of the narrative to emerge, and that this produces more fruitful interpretation of the narrative in question, Dr. Talbot offers her child-oriented reading of Bhaktivedanta in order to add to the extant interpretive possibilities for the narrative and to contribute to the expanding field of childist and child-oriented biblical scholarship. Members of Dr. Talbot's committee, Dr. Will Gaffney, Dr. Timothy Sandoval, and Dr. Russell Dalton congratulate Margaret on this impressive work. Dr. Margaret Murray Talbot.
Their particular call directly than we know them ourselves. But amid the wide diversity of these stories, there is a common theme. No one discerns your call alone. And so today we give you thanks for all of those who helped each of the graduates pursue their calling, their spouses, their partners, who walked the difficult path along these graduates, for the children who have moved to new apartments and new schools and new cities and new states so that their parents could study here, for the friends who have prodded and encouraged, and for all who have given themselves so that these graduates could be here today. Sustain all of this your servants in the steps that they will be taking when they take leave from this place. The stories of their ministries will be just as varied as their faces and their voices. In the world of violence and hateful rhetoric, remind them that they are called always to bear the good news, the words of reconciliation and healing and peace. Nurture their own hope, even in the places where all hope seems to be lost. And above all, inspire them to love so that all might come to know the love that comes only from you, the gift of your Son to this world. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Making all humanity in your image, and your presence throughout the world in all of life.
Thank you for the gift of redemption in Jesus Christ, in whom the Word became flesh and dwelt among us.
We rejoice that you have never in any time or place been without witness. We take joy in making known your deeds throughout the earth and in your transforming power. Church always witness to what the scriptures tell us, that all of humanity bears your image. We pray in Christ Jesus that the church may forever bring praise to you. Work your power in us to do far more than we dare ask or think. Amen.
Thank you.
not have much time to gladden the journeys of those who walk with us. So be swift to be kind. Work for peace and justice, diversity, equity, and inclusion. And be assured that the promises of God of all the ages are with you this day and go with you forevermore. In the name of the one who was,